This is Ramon Mejia from the LitRPG podcast. I just finished my interview with Jeff Hayes, the audiobook narrator for a lot of LitRPG stories that are coming out. We had a great time talking for a good long while about audiobook narration. What got him into that particular line of work, how he decides on which project he's going to work on. I just want to give you a heads up that there's a little bit of cursing. We're both grown-ups. We're talking about, you know, things, and we use grown-up words. Well, one of us does. But just letting you know in advance, in case, you know, you're listening to kids or whoever, don't want to be surprised. A couple words, adult words come up here and there. But it was a fun interview. Had a really good time. He does a lot of his live narration on Soundbooth Live, which is a Facebook live stream, and also on Twitch under the name Fiat Celebrity. So go check those out and enjoy the interview. Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the LitRPG Podcast. I am Ramon Mejia. And today I have the great honor to be speaking with the man known in the LitRPG world as the MC of LitRPG, the audiobook artist supreme, Jeff Hayes. Welcome to the podcast, Jeff.
What up, y'all? How's it going?
Thank you for being here, man. It's a great pleasure to have you. I know you and I actually met through the Facebook group on the LitRPG group. And then we also talked a little bit when I was looking for an audiobook narrator for my LitRPG book, Adventures on Terror. And I love your work so much. I've been following you ever since, especially on your Twitch channel, which is, remind me the name again.
Twitch.tv/FiatCelebrity is the URL, but the name of the show is Soundbooth Theater Live.
Yep, and it's actually really an interesting way of narrating your story. Now, I've often been curious about that particular, is it just you narrating for fun, or you're actually recording at the exact same time that you're live broadcasting your work?
Well, for a long time, I was recording while I was streaming at the same time. Actually, just recently, I changed that policy just because there's a little bit of a conflict there. When I'm performing in the booth with people watching, it's better to actually gear the performance a little towards that performance, right? But when I'm actually recording an audiobook, I need to pull it back a little bit. Right? I can't be so loud. I can't be so animated because I move away from the mic, and also it just gives me more editing work to do.
Right, so, right. Because then you have to edit out all those little blips and movements, yeah, and everything else, and re-record.
Right. And also it also gives me an opportunity to test out the voices, kind of. You know, I have a bunch of people there to give me feedback, and often the author will actually be there to comment and be like, you know what, maybe this voice could do this, you know, or hey, you mispronounced this, and it's fun for everybody that way. It's like they all feel like they're kind of part of the process, and I don't have to record it. I can take those comments and then I can re-record. Right. With those things in mind and create a better product.
Yeah. So awesome. So, you totally answered my curiosity question. I was just a little off topic because it just occurred to me. But I think it's a unique way of not only connecting with, the author that you're narrating for, but also with a larger community of people who just enjoy hearing good stories. It also gives you a chance, of course, to advertise your skills as a narrator to anybody who's interested in possibly getting an audiobook narrator. But I think it's a unique feature that makes you stand out, in my opinion, because that's kind of what drew me to you. Like, oh, he's really forward about his skills and just putting them out on Front Street and not being afraid of criticism or anything like that. And that to me it's pretty cool.
Yeah, transparency is definitely one of my main policies as a service provider, as a producer. I really want to be open with everybody that I deal with, not just the authors, but also with the people who are buying the products that I'm making. I want people to see the process, and I want to connect with them too, you know. And that's I didn't even come up with the idea. My buddy Mike Fenton suggested that I do it, and I was like, okay, let's try it out, and it just turned out to be really fun. So I've been doing it ever since.
Yeah, I think that's actually a really good point. It has to be fun if you're going to be doing it for a really long time, and if it's not, then it's just a job, and it's, you know, you can make money, but it's like, why not enjoy yourself while you're doing something like that? So that's cool. Like going back to just give people slightly broader knowledge about you and yourself. You're an absolutely prolific audiobook narrator. You've recorded over 60 books on Audible credits alone. You have 60 narration credits there. And your first audiobook credit goes back all the way back to 2013, which means you've been putting out like over 20 books a year. As far as being a narrator, that's absolutely an amazing amount of work that you put into your craft. And of course, you also do Soundbooth Theater Live, which we've already kind of chatted about a little bit. So you have
twice a week
product. I do a once a week podcast for this thing, and it's kind of a thing to do. So I can only imagine how much extra work you have to put in to do it twice a week.
I think I don't know. It's hard to say because I don't have to do any editing, right? You have to go back and you have to edit and you have to make sure you got to put the graphics in and stuff like that. And for me, the graphics are like all on the fly and they look kind of shitty. And everything. Oh, wait, I forgot to ask. What's the rating on your podcast? Are we PG? Can we go R? What's the deal?
You can go absolutely R if it gets like too weird and odd. I'll just throw in something at the very beginning saying, hey, folks, quick warning. Not for children, NSFW.
Gotcha. All right. Yeah, just wanted to make sure. I don't want to give you any more editing work.
No, it's fine, man. So you feel free to speak as freely as you want.
Yeah. So as far as the stream being work, actually the most work for the stream is farming the requests, getting people involved ask me to perform certain things. That's for my Sunday show, Requests Only, which is at 5 p.m. Central. And what I do is I allow people to request whatever they want. And lately, it's been a lot of authors. Lately, I've been doing all my auditions there. I haven't actually put an audition into ACX in maybe a month now, like at all. I mean, it's been going down and down because I've been searching for jobs in other ways, you know, just seeking people out on Facebook, searching through Amazon, finding the good books that have high rankings, and contacting the authors that way. But I almost never audition on ACX anymore because I'm just like, hey, come on my show. You know, I'll give you some. It'll be a way to promote your book, and you'll get to see how I do. You get to give me tips on certain characters. You get to interact with my viewers. You know, so it's like I'm trying not to waste my time auditioning, because with ACX, it's like if I do an audition, I record it and it probably takes about 20 minutes to do the audition, then do all the editing and send it into them. And then if I don't get the job, it's like it's just wasted time, you know,
but right.
Not the way I'm doing it here on Soundbooth Theater Live. It's like, well, I get to talk to the author. You know, they get to see me face to face. Well, they get to see my face. I don't usually get to see their face, but they get to see me, you know, actually doing it right in front of them. And even if they don't give me the job, I have I have content for my stream, you know,
right.
So it's no longer wasted work.
Yeah. No, you're definitely making sure that what you're doing counts in at least one stream of entertainment, if not in an actual getting a full gig from that narrator or from that author. So I get that it's really smart, to be honest. So yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Now just going back a little bit, your background as an audiobook narrator, you started in 2013. What got you into deciding to go into audiobook narrating?
Well, it wasn't really a decision. Even voice acting wasn't really a decision. It was like okay, let's try it. I always wanted to, since high school, I wanted to do music as a career. And recently, I discovered that that's not good for me, because I love music so much that I know that I would have to make music that I don't care about in order to make money at it, right? I wanted, my entire time as a musician, I was just making music that I wanted to listen to. And that means no one else wants to listen to it, because I'm out there, man. I listen to everything. I listen to progressive rock, and I listen to acid jazz and avant, just all kinds of crazy crap, and I incorporate all that into my music. So most of the time, the reaction when people listen to my music is, right? So that, you can't make money off that. Right? Like, and I think being a young person, and also because of the way that we're taught lately in the school systems, oh, you can do whatever you want. You can be anything. You want to be an artist? Follow your dreams. You'll make it, you know? And so when I'm not getting paid to do what I want to do, I get bitter, right? Instead of just coming to the realization and making peace with reality in the fact that you're not going to make money unless you're producing things that people want. So I had all this sound gear already.
Right.
I kind of gotten laid off, sort of. My parent, I was working for my parents for a long time because they had a lot of rental property, a lot of apartments and stuff. So I was their maintenance guy. And I hated that so much. It was, oh my God. Not only was the work not satisfying, but no one appreciates it. Like, none of the tenants appreciated what I was doing. You know, it's like, it's just, you know, dirty looks, you greedy landlord type of attitude that those people have. So it's like, I was glad. Well, this sounds awful to say, but I was glad when they decided to dissolve the business and sell off. You know, I was supposed to be taking over management and stuff, but my parents were having issues, and they decided to get rid of the business. So I was like out in the cold, like, okay, now what?
I don't know,
real job. Because then I'll be like, what, working in a kitchen or working on roofs or like things I just didn't want to do. So start getting on the internet. And then one day my friend Josh he sent me a job offer. Not a job offer. It was just a post, someone hiring for a radio broadcast thing. So I was like, I have a microphone, I have sound equipment, and I auditioned for it. And obviously I never heard back from him, but I was like, you know what? Voice stuff. Yeah, I'll try that. I'll see what I can do. And I found voices.com. And from there, I was able to make just enough to survive. But in order to survive, I had to do about 200 auditions a week. And I would land maybe two of those jobs, if I was lucky, per week. And so that was a lot of work for nothing, until I ran into an audiobook job.
Right.
And that actually paid, it paid really well for an audiobook job. So I was like, why am I going for all these little things? I should be going after these audiobooks, right? So I found a few more audiobook jobs on voices.com. Mm-hmm. And then I discovered ACX and their royalty share program and stuff. And so I just
now for the audience, what's ACX? So they know what we're talking about.
ACX.com is a subsidiary of Audible. And what they do is they connect indie authors with indie narrators. So through ACX, the authors will post their book, and they'll post whatever their budget is, whether they just want to do royalty share, which is what most people do, or if they have a budget that they can pay a certain amount per finished hour. So it's the easiest jobs to get are the royalty share jobs, because most of them don't make any money anyway, right? So none of the
As far as like an author's point of view, it's like, yeah, royalty share is less of a risk because you're not paying the narrator anything up front.
Yeah.
You're sharing the money you'd make on the money people would pay for the audiobook if they purchased it. So the author gets some of that money, the narrator gets some of that money, but it's no initial investment for the author to say, oh yeah, we'll do it this way. And if it sells, we both take money. And if we don't, well then nobody's really out of like $2,000 or $3,000, which is what it would kind of sort of cost if you were paying upfront to the narrator. Right. But in that circumstance, and the author gets all the money or that all the royalties.
Right. So just to be clear, actually there's for royalty share, the author has no risk.
Yeah. The author has no risk. Like, the narrator has the risk of time. Yeah, absolutely.
Right. Yeah. The narrator has to not only be in the booth and
right.
get it done there, but all the editing, the mastering, investing in the gear, right? Like narrators, they have to do a lot of work to get an audiobook done.
Right. As far as for the narrator, yeah, it's the same cost, whether they're getting paid up front or if it's a royalty share. Right. So what's for you as a narrator, which one is more appealing, I should ask? Well,
depends on the book. You know, if I look at a book and the ranking is crap, and they're willing to pay up front, I don't care. I don't care how well it sells. You know, if I'm getting money up front, whatever. But if it has a high rank, I want the royalties, because that lasts for 7 years according to the ACX contract. So that's 7 years of residuals on something that is already proven to sell.
Right.
Right. That's much better than getting, you know, a bunch of, you know, a fraction of that capital up front, I think. You know, I'm more of a long-term guy. So I like royalty share, but again, I do my research. I try and minimize my risk as much as possible. If it weren't for the fact that I'm trying to make a name for myself within the lit RPG genre, I wouldn't be doing so much royalty share work without asking authors to pay a certain amount of money up front, as well as the royalties, just so I can pay my editors.
Right. Because at this point, you've become so successful that you actually have a team of people working with you to get these out as quickly as possible. And it is high quality work at the same time. So you have, can we talk a little about this before we start recording? You have three people that you have to pay to help you get through all the narration stuff, editing, cleaning up, going through books to choose which ones you want to do, all the kind of good stuff.
Yeah, I have one person doing editing, one person doing proofing, and then the third person doesn't come into the equation as much. She's more of like a risk minimizer. You know, like if I see a book that I like, but I'm, you know, I don't have time to read every book that I'm considering.
Right.
So I throw it to her and say, "Hey, read this. Tell me if it's worth a damn. If it is, then I'll take the job. If it's not, I'll politely decline." You know. So, but yeah, that's, and I want to build my team even more. You know, I want to branch out into more than just audiobooks. You know, I want to have more services available to authors, like editing before the audiobook phase even comes before the audiobook phase. Like, you know, indie authors are infamous for not getting their stuff edited professionally, you know? So I want to find a way to integrate that stuff and bring more authors into that professional level.
Well, that's actually really nice. I mean, that way you can be not just the guy who does narration, but you'd almost be an indie, I don't want to say publisher, maybe an indie helper, writer helper.
I'm not sure how to label it yet, but you know, I'm always thinking of different ways to capitalize on what I'm doing. So,
yeah, I mean, you're already kind of sort of already going through it to read it. So you're going to be sort of proofing it in your mind as you read it.
Yeah.
At least that was the way that's the way it kind of turned out for my book. It's like, oh, as I'm like kind of editing it for the audiobook edition of it, taking out some tags, just rewriting things or, you know, cutting things out because they don't sound good. They don't sound as good as they read necessarily. Right. I'm like, oh yeah, there are more mistakes. And as the narrator reads, I'm like, oh yeah, I should have edited that out. And it's just a different opportunity. So if you're already doing it, why not provide the service, you know, to authors? Because like I say, indie authors don't have the cash to hire a narrator necessarily. Their first go, they might use beta readers. They might have friends and family help them do it. But, you know, nothing kind of replaces somebody whose profession is to edit and to help that author make as good a book as possible. So if you can provide that service and you're already, you know, kind of housing all these other parts together at the same time, like, oh, it benefits you, it benefits the author. So why not?
Yeah. Just to be clear, I'm not interested in editing myself.
Right.
I would be just talking to the author and say, hey, I have editors. You know, I have people who work for me who also do this editing stuff, and then hand it over to them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want everyone who works for me to get even more benefits than just me paying them. I want to give them opportunities outside of my own wallet, and you know, introduce them to authors and stuff. So it's more like I'm trying to create a network of people with common values as far as literature is concerned.
Okay. Well, that sounds perfectly cool. And like I said, sounds really interesting, to be honest. So thanks. So moving on to from your background a little bit and your ambitions, we already hit those 2 points a little bit more. Was there anybody in particular that inspired you to be a creative person? Because it sounds like music and audio have been a really big part of your life, your entire life, to be honest. It's hard for me to relate to that personally because I'm not as big of a music person. Like when you were listing all those things for music, I'm like, I have no idea what those genres are. I'm like, nope. and that's just like me. I'm like, I'm really simple oldies, musical stuff. And that's kind of it. And I listen to a ton of audiobooks, whether it's from LitRPG or from, you know, whatever, just because the type of work that I do, I can just plug in and tune out and listen to books. So that's a really big part of what I do with Latin podcasts, of course. So what musicians, what creative people inspired you to go into this type of work?
Well, if I'm going to name a musician who actually directly affects me, directly influences me in this particular job as a voice artist, it would be Mike Patton of Faith No More. I don't know if you're familiar with Faith No More. They're a funk metal band from the 80s, and they're legendary. And Mike Patton himself is the singer, and he's known as having one of the biggest, widest ranges of any vocalist out there. And not only can he croon like Frank Sinatra, but he screams like a metal guy, you know, kind of stuff, you know, like, and he's a composer. He has the bands Mr. Bungle and Phantomus, and he's just all over the place. And he's an example of a guy who does make whatever music that he fucking wants to and still sells. And it's just because he's so brilliant, right? And because he also had that mainstream introduction of working with Faith No More for so long. So I mean, he used that and now he's doing what I hope to do someday, which is just being paid to be himself. You know, I'm a creative person and he's an extremely creative person. And that's all he needs to do is just be him and make the things that he thinks should exist. And at some point I would like to get there in my career.
No, it's actually it's a very freeing experience to be able to just be, yeah. You know what I mean? And to just like, this is my work. I love it. I hope you do too. If you don't, that's cool, but I can make a living off of this. And I think for a lot of people, that's kind of a foreign experience. Like they have jobs to pay bills and maybe they don't love them. Maybe they're just good at that job. Mm-hmm. But for people, this is just something I've sort of experienced at this point in my life. I'm something like 34, I think. And this is like the first time I've had the opportunity. Yeah. I lose track sometimes, some years, somewhere around 34. But for me, this is like the first time I've ever been a creative person in any way whatsoever. Like I wrote a book, I do a podcast, I do, you know, this kind of stuff where there's visual or just audio stuff. And this is about as creative as I've ever gotten as far as like being artistic. I'm most of my life, it's math, science, history, some engineering stuff in school. But it was never the creative side of life. And just from personal experience, like it is super cool to like make something as an expression of yourself. In my case, a book, and have people say like, and have it resonate with people and have them be like, oh, this is awesome. I love this. And this was my introduction to LitRPG and thank you so much. And just get messages from people appreciating the world that you kind of created. And so I can only extrapolate from that it is as satisfying for an artist like yourself to be able to be kind of do the same thing and make something and have it connect to people in some way, shape or form, but also, you know, pay bills, because that's also important in the reality of life.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if you're not paying bills doing what you love, you got to do what you hate to get the bills paid. Right. And I so appreciate those people who do, because I'm sick of it. I'm done with it. But you know, the people that do the things that they do that they hate to get paid, those are the people that are buying my products primarily.
Yeah.
You know, those are the people listening to audiobooks because they don't need their ears to be engaged. They're doing some kind of menial labor or driving for a living, or, you know, like that's most of the consumer base for audiobooks is
people
who just need their mind occupied while they just do something they don't care about.
Well,
Most
they can do other things at the same time. I absolutely agree. Yeah, I listen to audiobooks for at least an hour and a half a day, or podcasts on my drive to and from work. And then plus my time on the job, you know, doing whatever, I can just plug in and kind of tune that part of my brain out and just, you know, do the thing. But you're right. It is a very big market that reaches a ton of people in the world who just kind of want to disconnect a little bit from that thing that they're doing and let their mind explore fantasy, a sci-fi world or whatever it is. And it's that to them is as entertaining as reading a book or looking at a movie. And, you know, if there's a need, you know, there's people there who can fulfill that need.
Right.
Okay. Now moving back into the Lit RPG community, which is what the podcast is about. Lit RPG. Yeah,
that's right.
It's us. You have recently come into that community of Lit RPG, which is for people, I hope they know, obviously, if they're watching the podcast, is it's literature that takes role-playing game mechanics like leveling up, damage notifications, skill notifications, those things you see in tabletop Lit RPGs or video games, and incorporates them into actual writing literature where they're not hidden away, but they're actually, you know, talked about upfront, frankly, and that's part of the draw of the genre, and that it connects to those other types of entertainment. Like tabletop games and video games, things other people can't connect to, or virtual reality, or whatever the case is. Now, how did you find Lit RPG, and why did you decide to start narrating those kind of books?
Well, I'm not sure if it's technically classified as Lit RPG, but I think the first exposure I had to the genre was Ready Player One. And I haven't even listened to it. I haven't even read it, but I used to hang out on r/audiobooks a lot. And that's all people would talk about. Like half of the conversation was about Ready Player One and how amazing it is. Okay. So I was like, man, I wish I could land a job like that. You know, it was not really something I knew how to pursue. And one day on ACX, I found William D. Aaron's Other Life Dreams. And ACX, for a while, I think they've stopped doing it now, but they used to have what was called the stipend program. And what that is if an author put their book on ACX and they just wanted royalty share, and the ACX magical gnomes that do the algorithms and stuff, if they see that by whatever their algorithm is, if they think that that will be a profitable book for Audible, they would put up $100 per finished hour themselves, ACX would, just to get it produced to the narrator.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I was always at. I was always there because not only does that mitigate my risk, but that's it. That's all it is. You know, like if I'm getting paid $100 per finished hour and getting royalties, like that's a big head start, I guess, and
right,
a big motivator for me. So Other Life Dreams was on stipend, and I read the concept and I was like, oh yeah, this is pretty cool. So I auditioned for it, and William got in touch with me almost like immediately. And we hit it off because we just get along. He's a cool guy. And I got really fascinated with the idea because I felt like Other Life Dreams was doing, not only was it dabbling in fantasy and sci-fi, which are the main genres that I was working in before I got that job, before I started Other Life Dreams, but it also had this meta feel to it, you know, where the writer was winking at the audience, you know, where the actual characters were winking at the audience. He's making references to video games, which I love video games. I wish I had more time to play them lately. And sometimes I do play them and then I don't get work done and then I feel guilty. Anyway, but it just the feel of it, I really clicked with. You know, I feel like video games are the new art form of our upcoming generation, you know, like the new opera, you know, the new, like, you know, when film first came out, it was like the new thing where they're incorporating all the arts into one. And talking about it now is very profitable. Talking about it and relating experience of video games within life. And we think of life in video game terms a lot of the time. Gamifying mm-hmm. life has become a thing. You know, like even like Uber, right? Like you keep track of all everything that you're doing on your phone, and you can see how much money you're making, and the phone, it's like on video games where they have a map and that there's a waypoint, you know, like, and you follow that to get to your destination. That's Uber, right?
Yep.
So it's really, I feel like it just reflects the way our lives are right now so much, LitRPG does, and especially Other Life Dreams. And Other Life Dreams also asks questions about what I think is the next generation of life form, which is artificial intelligence. I think that humanity is giving birth to this new life form that's going to transcend us and take existence to the next level. And in Other Life Dreams, I feel like, though, you know, the main character Runner, he has those moral quandaries where he has to make decisions between saving or helping a human player within the game, or helping and saving the women he's met that are actually AIs in the game, right? And they become more alive to him than the people. And the actual living people. So I just think that there's so much opportunity for depth in the genre that I couldn't resist looking for more. And not only that, it's super popular right now. And as you can see on the LitRPG Facebook page, everyone's ravenous. When's their next one? Like, they have every series, people are just clamoring, just trying to get more. And they can't get enough. So, yeah, that's why I got into LitRPG.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, I definitely agree just about every single point that you made. LitRPG has great opportunity for depth. Sometimes it's just adventure stories, action adventure. But a lot of time authors take the time, even if they're indie authors, like a first time writer like myself or Alan Hong or Travis Bagwell, whoever, writing their first story for the very first time, they still incorporate the things that they know and they love and the things that are important to them, whether it's, you know, subcontext of race, or, you know, artificial intelligence or you know, technology taking over our universes or whatever the case is. There's some, like, just like in any kind of good sci-fi literature, there's also kind of a sub-message or just interesting speculative fiction, making you think about, oh, the way that the world is going at the same time, but also entertaining, of course. So there's plenty of good stories that I absolutely agree with you with your points on our current world very much going very quickly to these LitRPG worlds that we're reading about in our communities of virtual reality being more popular, of our lives more and more just becoming gamified. Like, there are literally applications on Apple and Android devices. They can gamify every aspect of your life.
Yeah, I mean, look at the Fitbit, points, right?
Yeah.
The Fitbit, the Apple Watch, like keeping track of your heart rate and how mm-hmm. many miles you've walked today and all that stuff. Like, those are all things that you I'm sure there's like apps out there that give you achievements and shit, you know, like.
Yeah, like even beyond that, though, there are apps that give you actual experience points and levels for doing things like chores or paying bills or you know, running or washing the dishes. You can actually create lists of stuff and give experience points and levels for doing those things.
Oh my God, Pokemon Go.
Mm-hmm.
Pokemon Go. Look at how ridiculously that it just exploded all over everyone's faces. I'm so glad I didn't pick that up because I would have been right along with everybody else. You know,
Hey, it got me out of the house for like a week, so I can't say that it didn't work. And I'm not really an outdoor kid, but so, you know, me going around, walking around my neighborhood, it's like, wow, so this is where I live. Yeah. So now speaking about your game, you said you're a big gamer. What kind of games are you into?
I think if I were to narrow down a specific genre that I like the most, it would be survival.
Okay.
Fallout New Vegas, the hardcore mode is like some of my favorite shit, right? Lately I've been playing RimWorld. I just like the simulation of actual hardship, you know, because that's something that people of our generation and, you know, the new people don't know anything about. Like we think it's bad when we can't pay our bills, you know, well enough 1 month. Like there, people have starved to death. You know, we don't ever have to worry about that. Like no matter how poor either one of us are, we live in the United States. All we have to do is go ask someone for food and we'll get it.
Right. Yeah. You can literally do that. You're absolutely right.
There's no such thing as hardship anymore, at least for us. Like maybe we'll have conflicts with certain people who are douchebags. That's about as
right. There's no life and death.
Yeah.
Hardship kind of conflict in our life. Yeah. We're ultimately probably going to be okay. Yeah. But not that kind of survivalism. And it does very much feel a lot of time when you read it or seen a video game or, you know, The Walking Dead or whatever, it feels so fantasy because of the way we currently live that it's entertaining to see. Oh, so that's how you used to start fires and cook things and hunt.
Right. Right. So, I mean, I've also been playing Fallout 4 and even that I felt like was kind of crap until I started using the mods to make it more survivally. And Skyrim as well. I loved Skyrim when it first came out, and it wasn't even a survival game then. But then the special edition came out on Xbone, and I got the mods on it that made it a survival game where the cold actually affects you, and you have to hunt and kill animals and eat. Oh my god, it's so much fun. The permadeath kind of aspect where it's like you have to pay attention to what you're doing.
Right.
What I don't like about video games, and this is most video games because they're trying to appeal to a wide audience and they want 5-year-olds and grandmas to play as well, most of it's so easy and boring to me. You know, it's like there's no challenge. And that's what I really want out of a video game is challenge. I want to experience, like I said, hardship. Yeah. So I think survival is probably my my top genre at the moment. And
what about have you ever played Dark Souls? That's a very much survival game where hardship is and dying is a part of the video game, like in the entire franchise of that series.
You would think that I would really like that game, but the interface makes
it
completely unbearable for me. Like the menu, I can't figure out the character menus worth a damn. I mean, the last one I played was the first Dark Souls, not Dark Souls 2 or 3. I haven't messed with Dark Souls 2 or 3.
And they were on the PC?
No, I'm a console gamer. Sorry.
I had similar thoughts about it on the PC just because the controls were very obviously made for the console. And so like a PC import was just extra frustrating because nothing was laid out like it would be for a PC game. It wasn't really mouse and keyboard friendly. That added an extra layer of like, where is everything? Like there is no introduction. Like that game is super hardcore, even in figuring out how the user interface works. That's how hardcore that series is. And like Dark Souls 2 and 3 actually get a lot better for like doing a slight introduction of like, this is where your things are, and then go die.
Yeah.
And
own Dark Souls 3 and it's still in the cellophane.
Yeah.
I haven't touched it. So maybe I'll pick it up someday. But I like the philosophy behind it though, at least. They actually have, you know, all the bosses have very particular patterns. All the enemies have very particular patterns. And there isn't a single enemy that you can sleep on. Right. No.
And there's very little guidance. I mean, there's very little guidance as far as saying, like, oh, here's his special, you know, weak point. Hit him here. Or this is how you get through it. Or like little hints. Like, nope, they just throw you in and they're like, there you go. go have a good time dying and figure it out for yourself. And that very much harkens back to like the early 80s, 90s video game franchises where they were intentionally hard to get you to put more quarters into the arcade machine. Yeah. And that's why they were so difficult, because they wanted you to keep popping in those quarters so they can make money. And as consoles became a thing and PC gaming became a thing, they wanted more people to spend just 20, 30 hours on a video game and not feel as frustrated and throw it out the window. And so gaming philosophy has changed since it, but a lot more people feel like you do it, that these video games are just too easy. Yes, they're entertaining, and there's a story there, and there's an opportunity to tell a sometimes very interesting speculative fiction that makes you think, especially through things like Mass Effect or, you know, the zombie apocalypse and, you know, all those interesting themes. But at the same time, people also want to be challenged. And if they spent 20, 30 years as a gamer, like, you know, myself, then you've kind of already mastered a lot of those basic genre skills. And so getting any kind of challenge is always its own special interest and reward.
Yeah. Lately games are more about instant gratification. Yeah. That's the main thing. Level up, loot. You know, that's why I can't get into MMOs, because not only are other players annoying as hell, but it's just about that Skinner box. You know, it's just about continually bringing your numbers up and becoming more powerful. And it's more like an addiction. That's what it seems like to me. Like it's more like just an addictive activity rather than an actually satisfying experience that you can take into the real world.
Oh, and that's a very interesting point. And that actually is a big draw for some people, and especially within the LitRPG community, because that same kind of aspect is told within our stories, our community stories, in that at that progression level up. But if that doesn't mean anything, you say, in whether in the story or in your life, then there's a disconnect. There's not a satisfaction. And it is, and part of it, it is an addiction, but I think it's also a reflection of our society, in that we're not being fulfilled in our everyday lives with our jobs or within our communities or within our social structures. And
not to the extent that the numbers give us gratification.
Yes.
Right? And that's pretty sad.
Yeah. And it's very much the case that those numbers do give satisfaction, because they're concrete. They're things that say, oh, you've actually made progression to this point, instead of some vaguely defined terms with your girlfriend saying, hey, so where are we at? Where are we going? And, you know, that kind of progression where it's not defined, where the world doesn't make sense. So within video games, MMOs or LitRPG, the world makes sense. And so there is that possibility of understanding things, at least to me as a reader and as a gamer, those things are part of the draw for video games and LitRPG. Okay, moving on to our next question. We have the narration audiobook process. I've actually been really interested about like how you structure your day, how you structure your work to actually go from audition to final product. So how does that process of narrating work for you?
I actually, my process is totally fucked right now. I'm just kind of flying by the seat of my pants at this moment, because I've increased my output so much, and I'm trying to find a balance between hunting for jobs, which is part of the thrill, to be honest. Like, I think I'm spending too much time on that right now just because it's fun. actually getting in the booth and getting the things done, and actually, you know, making sure that the workflow between everyone on my team is efficient, which I'm not doing a good job with that either. You know, like I have to be a leader at this point with these projects. So I'm learning how to do that better. Some days I don't get any recording done. Some days I'm in the booth for like 5 hours at a time. But I somehow managed to get it done. And if I have to lose sleep for it, or if I have to cancel plans with friends to go out drinking or whatever, then I got to do that. But,
Look at you being a grown up.
I know. Has to happen someday. But that's process, man. I have to focus. That's all I'm thinking about right now is just focus, remember my deadlines, you know, remember what's coming up, remember who you're actually dealing with as far as authors. Or like right now I'm working with, I'm doing another book for Podium Publishing, who actually did The Martian, which is the best-selling audiobook ever, I think. And so I'm doing the sixth book for them, and I got to be on top of my game and make sure I get it in on time.
Right.
Because people in the industry, you don't want to mess around, right? But with authors, especially with royalty share stuff, you know, there's more leeway there because they have nothing invested. They just go, okay, make my audiobook, and I'm like, okay, you know. So they don't have to lift a finger, basically.
No, that's I understand that portion. Like with my narrator now, it's kind of the same thing. I'm doing full pay up front, and we're about going on 2 weeks behind our original schedule because she got sick. And so I'm like, okay, I'm like, to me it's not a big deal, because I'm like, you know, it's an audiobook, it'll come out. Like the big rush and popularity of my book has kind of gone down a little bit, so it's not going to be as popular anyways. It'll pick back up when I put out book two, so I just want it there for that instance. So it's not a huge, it's a little bit later, because I didn't expect to put an audiobook with an actual book, because I wasn't sure my actual book was going to be successful enough. Mm-hmm. So it's not a huge on my part, but I understand that from a more professional company who's actually doing this for a living, like they want their deadlines hit. You cannot mess with that. You have to be in communication. You have to give them enough leeway time to do edits and re-recordings and whatever changes they want you to make. And so that schedule is a little tighter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That's the way it is. So, when it comes to being sick as a narrator, I've been tempted to be like, I don't care. I'm sick, but I need to get this done. No, you can't do that, because then the quality of the product suffers. That's just all there is to it. You're not even worried about getting someone else sick. That's not the point. It's not about the work being too hard to do. It's about what is my voice going to sound like.
Right. And that's very much that's the whole product. So if it doesn't sound good, everybody suffers.
Yeah.
Okay. So walk me through the process of getting, we'll start off with the beginning. So how do you get jobs for narration? We'll start there.
I cruise around Amazon. I look for what's successful. And lately I've been specifically targeting LitRPG. I watch the Facebook page. I talk to authors on Facebook. And lately, because of Soundbooth Theater Live, especially, I've been getting a lot of calls from authors coming to me, you know, looking for me to do it. So
right.
It's really just a matter of selling my particular way of producing. I think more like a producer than I think like a narrator. Most narrators are just focused on their method, and well, they're focused on their voice, right? They're focused on themselves as a delivery, whereas I'm thinking of the product as a whole and making it a show, right? They're seeing it as an audio version of a book. I'm seeing it as an audio experience made out of the scenery that the author is talking about and the characters that make that story up. So that's what I'm trying to sell the author, is the experience, right? I'm trying to sell to them, look, you're not just getting an audio version of your book from me. You're getting a whole new way for people you're getting something almost like your listeners are getting a look into your own brain, you know, what you are seeing as you put the pen to paper. Obviously no one uses pen and paper anymore, but you know what I'm saying?
Finger to keyboard. Yeah.
Right. Finger to keyboard. Right. I'm just trying to stand out. That's the main thing. That's what you have to do as an artist in any industry, I think, in any entertainment. is what separates me from everyone else. And I think that's what it is. So that's
okay, how perfect. I go to sell. Okay, perfect. Now, let's say as an author, because a lot of people who are going to watch this podcast are going to be authors or just readers. If they wanted to get an audiobook made from their work, where would they go? You mentioned, I think, voice.com and acx.com. Anywhere else that you look for jobs as a narrator that they would go to post them?
I would not suggest voices.com. That's just kind of adding an extra middleman that you don't really need. Go to ACX if you're an indie guy and if you want to stay indie and if your sales aren't good enough to attract the bigger publishing places. There's also plenty of smaller publishing companies like Podium who are constantly scouring Amazon for new titles, new content. And sometimes you can approach those people. I mean, let's see, Podium, Brilliance, Dayan, or I can never remember how to pronounce that. Deyan. They're based in LA, I believe. There's lots of different studios that you can approach, but you have to have the right sales numbers to actually get them interested.
Okay. So what kind of sales numbers would just ballpark, what do you think would interest those kind of companies to kind of take up the production inside of their audiobook stuff?
I mean, I'm sure you have to be selling upwards of 1,000 copies a month. I mean, even that sounds low for what they'd be looking for. But it not only has to have good sales numbers, but good ratings. The cover has to look professional. Everything about it has to be professional looking in order for a studio to actually take a look at your stuff. But ACX is always there, you know, and there's plenty of talent on ACX.
Yeah.
Indie narrators.
So, I definitely agree that ACX is a much easier place. Like a lot of the stuff that Amazon does is very much geared towards the self-publishing community, people who don't quite fit into the traditional publishing and who also aren't trying to give their stuff away for free. They're the place in the middle that allows people who feel like they should get paid for their work, who feel like their work is good enough to actually publish, to do it, whether it's on Amazon, you know, Kindle Direct Publishing, or whether it's on ACX, which connects, you know, indie author with the narrator and allows them to get their scripts read or the portions of their book read. They just upload a small portion of a sample of their novel. They put out whether they want to do a royalty share or if it's going to be a straight paid thing. That's fine. And then they kind of put a range of like if they're going to pay directly what they're looking to pay, whether it's $100 per finished hour or $300 or $400 per finished hour. And then people audition. People like yourself will say, oh, yeah, I'll read the script. I'll give you a 15-minute sample or a 10-minute sample, whatever it is. And then the author decides, okay, I like this person, or I want to go for a second round with these five or six people. And then it's just as simple as like picking a person, and the contract is automatically made. Everybody agrees to it and it's really clear. And then you go into production, you know, so it's that simple with ACX at least. And I really like that particular model because it made all the technical stuff so easy to do. I don't have to write a contract. I don't have to worry about, you know, everything communication wise is done through them. So there's a record of it and everybody knows up front what they're expecting, what they're getting out of the project, without having to have any kind of fear of like, oh, am I undervaluing this person or am I overpaying them? It's so easy.
Yeah, it really is. It's a snap and things get done like that. The downside to ACX compared to those publishing houses, of course, is that you just don't get the kind of exposure that you would with those publishing houses. Those publishing houses, they have marketing teams, you know, they have connections with the Audio Publishers Association, and they you know, they get reviews from the top reviewers in the industry. So, I mean, your title's going to get more attention, but you're not going to get as much of a percentage of royalties. They're going to take a little bit of that, right, per unit. But the number of units is going to go way up. So,
yeah,
if you have an opportunity to work with one of the publishing houses, you should probably take it.
Yeah, it kind of depends on the model that you're working for. Like, for a lot of the LitRPG community, it's just such a small amount of people who are buying it currently that it's just not interesting enough for a lot of big publishers. But at the same time, it also means that narrator, like self-publishers like myself, get to keep all those royalties for themselves and not necessarily lose out on the advantages that a larger publisher would bring necessarily. Like I don't think that the jump from the smaller indie community to the larger publisher would necessarily benefit every lit RPG author, just because their books might not be geared as mainstream as other titles necessarily. But every case is different though.
Maybe for most lit RPG guys, that's true, but lit RPG is making it to the publishing houses to certain, some of them, like the game with the three at the end, that's Podium. Yeah. Podium picked that one up. And then there's another one that Luke Daniels narrated. I believe the game with the three is Terry Scott that narrated it, but what was it? Crap, now I have to look it up because I'm curious. And also Jeff Sproul with Sigil Online, Paragon Sigil Online, he actually got an offer from Podium as well, and he turned him down because he wanted to work with me. But, I mean, he could have just said, oh, well, I want to work with Jeff, and they'd say, okay, and they'd hire me. But,
I think you'll find the same challenges and maybe benefits between the self-publishing model and, you know, this traditional publishing model in the audiobook space. Like, yes, if you're self-publishing, you have a lot more headaches. You have to be your own marketing team. You have to be your own editors. You have to be your own producers. But at the same time, you get to keep more of the money.
I'm being an idiot. Okay, so The Game by Terry Scott is the one that Luke Daniels did, and that's Podium. The Game is Life Book One. That's the one. And then The Game with the three, I can't remember who narrated that one. By Cosimo Yap. Cosimo.
Yeah, that's the author. Yeah.
Nick Podell narrated that one. So both of those are podium titles, and Sigil Online could have been I advise Jeff, hey, take a look at their offer. And I would advise anyone to do that because it's a way to get exposure. Personally, I'm trying to be my own thing. I'm trying to be a producer myself. I hope one day to have the kind of name that Podium does, that people see that name and say, oh, quality. Okay.
Hayes Production.
Yeah, exactly. I want to be there at some point, but at this moment in time, I'm just not. So.
No. Yeah. And that's fine. There's absolutely nothing wrong with being your own thing and just being a one man operation or a two or three man operation. If that works for you, your bills are paid, right? I mean, you're good to do the thing that you like. So there's nothing wrong with being a small operation. It's one of the things about our modern technological based society is that to be successful, you don't have to be a big firm. You don't have to necessarily go that route. In a lot of people's minds, they're not successful unless they sign with the big publishing house or if they sign with the big, narration audiobook producer. To me, it's very much the opposite way. Like our society is ubiquitous enough that there are people who just make videos on YouTube or on, it used to be 3-second videos or whatever, and they become world famous because the platform allows them to reach their audience, and they don't need necessarily the middleman of a producer or big publishing house to reach their audience anymore. And I think that also applies to things like self-published books or self-published audiobooks. You don't necessarily need that middleman to do all the work because of social media, because of YouTube, because of Twitch, because of all these different opportunities to reach your audience directly. And I think that's a benefit that didn't exist before that people can take advantage of and still be successful.
Absolutely. And the advantage of being indie is that you don't have to pander to larger audiences, and that's what the bigger publishers do have to do. They have to make sure that all the things align with as many people as possible. They have to make sure that the products they put out are appealing to the lowest common denominator if they want to survive, because they're just so big. They have so many people to pay, that if if it's not appealing to everyone, they're not going to bother. But if you're indie, right, you can still make whatever the hell you want. Your operation costs are so low that if just enough people are into what you're doing, well, then that's enough, you know, and you can still be happy and produce exactly what you want to produce. So yeah, absolutely. I agree. And that's why I want to stay indie mostly, you know. I mean, don't get me wrong, I like working with Podium, but I'm not going to put effort into getting into the mainstream of publishing, because there's just as much crap in the mainstream publications as there is in the indie publications. It's just they get more exposure,
right?
You know, you get more famous, and it's like, is that even necessarily a good thing? Like, do I want everyone to know who I am? I don't know. I don't think so.
No, I heard you're saying, yeah, but Podium, if you're listening, Jeff Hayes is absolutely satisfied working with you at this moment. Please don't cancel the contract.
Right, absolutely, yeah.
No, yeah, so I heard you're saying, like, they're just, you have to decide at some point whether the risks outweigh the rewards, or, you know, if they're too much for you, not traditional, but if you're willing to take the extra work of being an indie publisher or any audiobook creator, this might be a thing for you. So we've talked a little bit about the getting a job or posting a job for an audiobook narration. So once you decide on this is the project I want to work on, what do you do after that?
So then you set your budget. You say, do I want just royalty share? Do I have some money set aside where I can actually pay up front to get it done? And those are when I say I think more like a producer than a narrator, it's because I am looking more for the royalty stuff. I am looking at it from that angle and in the long-term investment angle, whereas most narrators are just looking to get the job and get on to the next job.
Right, because so, they have bills to pay. I understand that.
Yeah. So the best narrators on ACX are looking for the $200 to $400 per finished hour range.
So for like a 10-hour book, that comes out to like $2,000 or $3,000 if you're paying all up front.
Yeah. I mean, my rate is $350. So if you're not doing royalty share for me, if you got a 10-hour book, that's $3,500.
Mm-hmm.
So,
which is, you know, not anything to sneeze at, but potentially long term, if it's a good seller, you can make even more than that.
Absolutely. Again, that makes me think, well, then why am I taking that? Why would I want just the $350 per finished hour when I can be making money for 7 years on this
thing, right,
if it sells well? So, and that's why I'm trying to develop my brand, so that no matter what book I take, the risk is mitigated to a minimum because people are going to pick it up just for having my name on it. Right.
So, right.
That's why I'm why I say I think more like a producer. The way that the narrator community thinks is that people aren't buying books because of the narrator's name. They see the narrator's name and they say, oh, well, it won't be bad. It won't be badly narrated because this guy is good enough, right? He won't distract me. He won't, there's less risk involved in being calm and just delivering it well enough to where people can consume it comfortably. You know, what I'm doing is riskier because, I mean, the people who like my stuff love my stuff, but the people who don't like my stuff fucking hate my stuff, right? Because they feel like it's pandery. They feel like it's for kids, or, you know, there's one of my favorite bad reviews is, they said they felt like they were listening to Sesame Street, you know? So, I mean, as a voice actor, I'm like proud of that.
Thank you. Yes. You know, Sesame Street's been running for decades. I hope I worked that long.
Yeah. Well, not only that, but all the voices are fucking amazing in that show. Right. Like, yeah, they're cartoony, but they're evocative and it really brings each one of those Muppets to life.
Yeah, and their name brand voices. I mean, you know Sesame, you know Big Bird's voice, you know Elmo's voice. As soon as you hear it, so if that's what they're comparing you to, hey, I hope everybody in the United States knows your voice at some point.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, there's it's a high risk, high reward thing that I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully high reward. I mean, it's been high reward so far. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. And
absolutely. So you got the project, you've agreed on a budget. So you have the script in your hand. Like, what do you do at that point when you're reading through it? How do you develop your voices? How do you structure your day so you get your content done? And then what do you do to move on to editing and cleaning it up? Okay, how does all that work for you?
Are you talking just for an audition or for, okay, I took the job and now I'm about,
I'm assuming you've took the job. So okay. You've taken the job.
So I take all the that, job. Yeah. I take the job. Then I read the entire book and
okay.
I try and figure out, okay, what's the subtext? What is this book about? That's the main thing. Right, because that's going to inform my tone overall. How do I want the listener to feel while they're listening to this? And that goes for chapter by chapter as well. What is this chapter? What is happening in this chapter? What am I trying to? What part of the story am I telling here? What are the characters feeling in this environment they're in? How do the sounds make them feel? What does it smell like in there? What is a person that's describing a smell going to sound like when they tell you what it smells like, right? And that all goes into the narration. You know, I want to pull the listener in, and I want them to be in that spot. I don't want them to hear words. I don't want to see them. I don't want them to see a person reading a book. I want them to see the scene. Then I think about the characters, and I think about their relevance in the story. And I think about who they are as individuals. And that's how I start coming up with voices. And I don't, most of the time I'm not coming up with a new voice for each character. Most of the time it's kind of like I'm a casting director. I have a troupe of actors in my head. And I go, okay, who's the best guy for this role? You know, who can play this main character? Who can play the girlfriend? Who can play the guy's boss? You know, and it all just depends on who those characters are in the book. And once in a while, I do have to create a new voice. And that becomes a new actor that I put in my head that I can take to the next job. So it is like having a casting director job. It's like fitting the actors to the characters and making sure that they embody the role as well as possible. So those are the main things I'm thinking about. How to make okay. a show, how to pull the listener in.
So at that point, it almost feels like you're auditioning for roles in a play, and that you're trying to find the right voice to fit this particular character, and you're planning out your kind of the tones that you're going to use within the story as you read it. Depending on the scene, depending on the tone of the story, if it's really high fantasy or if it's really dark fiction, you know, whatever the case is. So that's the planning phase. And then at what point do you actually go into the booth and start recording? What happens from there?
From there, I'm listening to myself. You know, I'm making sure that I do have that right tone, but I also just kind of trust myself as well. If I've read the book, I always read the book from front to back before I get in the booth and start recording. If I have that concept already within me, a truly good book is, I mean, that stuff's just going to be natural. You know, an author can really tell you who their characters are with their dialogue very well. And they really can tell you what the book is about. Just through narration, not telling you, but showing you. So that's there in my heart already when I get into the booth. And it's rocky at first, you know, from the first chapter, I'm like kind of stumbling around. I'm like, maybe that wasn't right. And I'll go back and I'll make changes. But eventually I get into the swing of things and it's just natural. So I just kind of trust myself to make it happen once I've totally digested the work.
Okay. So then do you record the entire book at once and then edit it, or do you do it piecemeal? Like, I'll record chapter one, send it off to editing, and then record chapter two, send it off to editing. How does that work for you?
I record as much as I can at once. Now, obviously there's enough hours in a day that I could in theory, record one book in 2 days. But in that time, my voice is going to deteriorate. You can't just sit in the booth and record all day, because, I mean, after 4 or 5 hours, my voice becomes crappy, no matter how much effort I put into it. It's not a matter of not being willing to work. It's just, it doesn't sound good anymore.
Right. So, physical limitations.
Right. So I gotta pace myself in that way. So, I mean, most books take 4 or 5 days in the booth of work. And now I really like shorter books, because I can pump them out much faster. But also, I just feel like shorter books is just better composition, tighter composition. You know, I think shorter books, it's economical, you know. And I know that listeners prefer longer books because it fills up more time. You know, they feel like they get more bang for the buck, but I would rather a book be short and tight to a point that I want to listen to it again and again, you know, because there's just so much packed in there. But you know, books will get marked down for not being long enough. And I think that's a shame. I wish that listeners had a different attitude about that.
Like, there's some other metric to measure the quality of the project besides hours of listening time?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, hours of listening time. It's like for me, the longer a book looks, the less I want to listen to it, because it's like, I have stuff to do.
Yeah. You know? It's definitely an investment of time.
Yeah, exactly. And to me, that's part of the cost of listening to a book, is how much of my time is it taking? Now, for a lot of people, like we said before, they're listening while they're doing something else anyway, mm-hmm. right? So it's not really that much of a time investment for them to be listening to an audiobook. So the longer it is, the better it is for them, because they don't have to go and buy something else. But again, I mean, repeat listens, replayability, just like a video game. You know, maybe a video game's short, maybe there's not much to it as far as content, but if it's infinitely replayable, who cares? Right? Like RimWorld, for instance, the game that I mentioned earlier, it's all isometric, 2D, complete, like extremely minimal graphics, you know, like Minecraft, infinite replayability. You just want to keep going back, because there's so much substance to what you're doing. You know, it's so fun that you can just play and play and play and play, and there's no storyline.
Right.
There's no beating the game. It's just designed in a way that's just constantly satisfying.
Right. And no, definitely replayability of an audiobook is a draw for some people. It's not a draw for everybody, obviously. Some people like one and done it. Like, they'll pay, you know, $23 for a 12, 16 hour book and not listen to it again ever, because they want to move on to the next thing or the next story after that. That very much plays it into sort of the video game mindset of like, I played this game, I beat it, I might come back to it in a couple of years, but for now, there's so many other things to listen to, so I'm going to go to those other things instead. So they're both sides of it. But after, let's say you've narrated it, this is just my personal experience. I will record something, but then it takes me like 2 or 3 hours of editing work to clean it up sometimes, especially in the beginning when I was like pretty new at what I was doing. Does it take you a similar amount of time to clean up your editing work? Because I know I've listened to you record on Soundbooth Live, where it's like, you'll sometimes you make mistakes, you make pop noises, you re-record, sometimes things will go off in the background, the dog will bark, a car will drive by, whatever it is. Yeah. And so at some point, you have to either re-record it or edit it out. And so the part of what you bring to the table is not just voice, it's also the ability to make your work sound clean and understandable and pleasurable for your listeners, which means editing out all that other stuff that comes out in there. And I've talked to my narrator personally. She's like, oh yeah, sometimes I'll just go on this weird little conversation with my dog, because she'll walk into this room as a record and I'd have to remember to edit it out later. And so all that stuff has to be done by editor. So how much time do you spend recording and how much time do you spend editing?
Well, as I said, I have a team to take care of most of my editing and proofing now, but I still do have to get in there and do production. I use sound effects, not literal, like, you know, gunshots and like dogs barking or whatever, but like I use effects like a guitarist would have a pedal board, right? You know, they have the distortion, they have the delay and stuff like that. I use those things to create certain effects for different characters or for different scenery. So I do some of that. But editing really is the bulk of the work. Obviously, it takes a certain type of person to record what I record, you know, so it's like, it's a very specific skill set that I do, but the actual editing is the bulk of the busy work. Like I'd say 30, maybe even 25% of the work is actually recording and the rest is production. The rest is editing and mastering and exporting and making sure everything's perfect as a product. Your narrator said that she has to record, like she has to edit out things like her talking to her dog or, you know, things that distract her. Like I don't even, you know, I'm like editing while I'm recording too. So that I'm past that phase. I mean, I know that your narrator is relatively new and I'm glad that, you know, it's always good to have new talent. And, from what I heard from the sample that you showed me, I'm excited for you because she sounds like she's already good at delivery. But the actual editing aspect takes a lot of time and eventually she'll have to streamline her process because, you know, just recording through things that are happening that isn't narration. That's a pain in the ass, man. That's creating a lot of extra work for her.
It is. I absolutely agree with you. Just from perspective of like recording a podcast and trying to edit it later or recording interviews and reading and like, all the little things that you can take out of your initial recording that aren't necessary saves you so much work because then you don't have to hunt down for it in the audio file. You don't have to re-listen to sections again and again and again to re-record or to cut out. So as little editing work as you can create for yourself, the better off you are
The method is called punch and roll, where if you mess up, you stop, you bring the playhead back to where you messed up and you start recording again. So you're already recording over the part where you messed up. You know, you don't leave that junk in there for the editor to take care of because it's just more work for them. And and if you're working with a professional, they're going to get irritated quick. So
like it's a learning experience for everybody. Just like an indie writer like myself, like I have no experience to base my work on. So in my initial writing of book one, there was a process I went through and it was really messed up and it was kind of messy and unorganized. But book two is better. It's a little more streamlined. And I feel like that's going to be the process for anybody who either wants to write as a self-publisher or get into narration. There's going to be a learning curve of best practices and what works for you the best as far as like recording and editing and producing and all that work. Okay. So real quick before we end up this interview, we've been talking for a good hour and a half-ish already. I know. Like, time goes by, man. I wanted to talk a little bit about marketing of an audio because that's something that's going to be I'm going to have to learn about once my audiobook is produced. So this is mostly for me. Like, how do you market your audiobooks? Or if people want to know how, as a self-publisher, as a self-audiobook producer, what's a good way to market their audiobooks?
I have no idea. Okay. I'm awful at marketing. That's another reason why I started Soundbooth Theater Live. I'm like, you know what? I don't know what to do. What just engage people, I guess. You know, talk to people who care, who you know already care about the kind of product that you're putting out. Most of the time, really it's just dependent on the book itself. You know, you just go back to that. Who likes your book? That's who you market the audiobook to. It's just another way to experience your book. So start from there. You know, you personally, you're with this podcast. This is your marketing.
Yeah.
Right. You're a person that people look to in the community to find out what's good already. So they're gonna buy your products. Right. So you're I think you're fine as far as marketing is concerned. Do what you're doing. Keep making these podcasts because that's you're engaging with an audience. People know who you are because of that. And they're, I mean, you saw when you released it immediately, you jumped up to what, past number 100 in the entire Kindle market for a while. I mean, that's incredible for a first title. So absolutely. I think you're doing the right thing so far. Personally, I don't know if I'm doing things right or not. You know, I'm still, there's a book that I just released called Clan. I thought for sure it's going to do well. Mm-hmm. It's so good. And it has sold 6 copies so far.
Okay. So what's Clan about? Let's Clan, take the opportunity to talk about that for a second.
Let's do a little marketing here. Clan is a sci-fi dystopia about a society of clones of one guy.
Okay. So this is like multiple man as a society.
Yeah. And it's incredibly disturbing and heart-wrenching and but also touching, you know, and it's really like looking into a mirror, you know, because it makes you ask questions about yourself, you know, like who would
I thought you'd be like, it looks like looking in a mirror because you see everybody that looks like you. Like, oh, okay.
Well, but yeah, that's literally the analogy, right? Like all the main character is just a clone that's the same as everybody mm-hmm. else, just this much different, you know? So everyone he looks at, everyone who's a problem in his world is a reflection of himself. He's constantly right. battling himself. And
okay. So yeah, I'm reading this is by Realm Lovejoy, performed by Jeff Hayes. The publisher summary, clans are unity, no variation, no deviation. Enclades, to be a clan is to be an exact copy. A perfect society cloning themselves to survive, even as the zombie-like frags threaten to overrun that on an unforgiving planet. Clan number 1672, probably known as Twain, was never supposed to survive the incubation tank, but he did, illegally. He is different from other clans. He has a secret that could destroy him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and it's incredibly well written. I'm so happy to have been a part of that project. And I feel like the best books that I narrate sell the worst.
Like I'm sensing a theme here. Like the stuff you love the most doesn't appeal to as many people as you would like it to appeal to. Like yeah. a lot of stuff, music wise, story wise, they're really interesting, but they're also super kind of artistic and that they don't get technical. They're difficult and, right. and things that are difficult like that just aren't as appealing necessarily to everybody, or at least they don't go out of their way to find them. Like it's hard to market something like this, I think, in particular, because it's very much, it falls more in the narration of speculative than sci-fi or fantasy or, you know, adventure or action, whatever the case is. This story, just from the summary, it very much feels like it's not even quite sci-fi speculation, but as much as it is speculative fiction. And so unless it finds its audience very quickly, and it's hard for people to connect to it necessarily, because this very much sounds like an interpretation of society, in that our society currently, it's becoming more ubiquitous with internet, television, cable television, all around the world. Societies are becoming less distinct. So if you extrapolate that to like a far future where on some future society where you have a smaller gene pool, but you still need to survive, well, cloning becomes a viable option. And from there, just thinking about everybody being a same clone society, then everybody being the same and no variation, no deviation allows for maximum survival because you know what to expect. You know everybody's role. But does that work for an individual who is not exactly the same as everyone else in a society where that's what's expected? So there's a combination of societal expectations and also individuality. What works best? What's more important? And that, I think, becomes part of the question of this particular novel without having read it at all. But I assume is part of the draw and the interesting part of the storyline. And that unfortunately is not, you know, space pirates or, you know, swordplay necessarily. That's very much a thinking man's sort of book. And sometimes that does very successful. You think of The Handmaid's Tale, which is very much along the same lines of a thinking book. And it's taken, well, that was written like decades ago, and it's only now being made into like a Hulu series. But it took that long for it to become as popularized enough to support that kind of a thing. So that, I think that's part of it.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing about Clan is the action that's in it. It's not like fantasy or sci-fi action. It's more like horror action.
Yeah.
The book is disturbing. And I think that what really made me love it is the points in time that made me want to put it down.
Ah.
Because
it's one of those disturbing books.
Like where it's like you're getting into territory where you're asking yourself questions.
Yeah.
About you and just bringing you to uncomfortable places. Yeah. So yeah. And that has to do with fitting in, you know, like clone, like imagine being a clone in a society of clones and not being able to fit in. Everyone's right. Literally the same, but you're still being rejected.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is horrifying.
Yeah. It's hard to make that tagline for a book. This novel will make you uncomfortable.
Yeah. So I don't know.
No, it's okay. So I'm glad you like this project, but I mean, it's always sad to me when good stories don't find their audiences necessarily, because I always try to match my, you know, stories to their audiences. And I always love seeing people become enthusiastic about a story or an audiobook or whatever it is. And so if this is a story that's just not getting the press, hey, people in the audience, if this is the kind of story that appeals to you, go pick it up on audiobook or ebook. And, you know, maybe this is a whole new genre of interesting speculative horror clone fiction.
Yeah. Speculative horror clone fiction. Yeah. I like that.
Very good. Okay. So that's kind of it. We talked about marketing, got all our stuff out of the way, all the things we're going to look for. You've given some great information about narration, audiobook stuff. So I appreciate it. So thanks so much for taking the time to talk to me. Was there anything else you want to talk about that I haven't included at this point?
Not really. Just go to the Soundbooth Theater Live Facebook group if you wanna talk to me, if you wanna make requests for my Sunday show, just post there. Join the Facebook group. Talk to people there. I mean, everyone who watches my show, they're really funny to talk to on the chat. So yeah, definitely come to Twitch and hang out with us sometime.
Yeah, and that's also at Twitch is a Fiat Celebrity, I believe, right?
Yeah, I'm gonna be rebranding the Twitch to fit the actual name of the show here soon. Once my website is done and once I have a central place for everyone to go to, I'm planning on the Soundbooth Theater website to be its own entity and I want traffic to go through there. You know, I want people to interact there, and I'm going to be embedding all three different sources of the stream because I'm on Twitch and Facebook Live and YouTube. I'm trying to reach as wide an audience as possible, make it as comfortable for whoever wants to watch the show to watch the show. And I'll be archiving and I'll be starting a blog there, talking about the different authors that I'm working with and maybe a little bit of my own opinions about life and stuff like that. You know, I'm trying. I think Soundbooth Theater Live is my way of engaging people and being more a part of people's lives and not just being the products that I make for Audible. So
no, you're creating a community with Soundbooth Live. It's the same thing that I kind of ended up doing here, is that you're talking about something you love, you're doing something you enjoy, so it doesn't feel like work. But you're also connecting to an audience that feels the same way. And so you're in a sense creating, even if it's a small community, a group of people that have similar interests and views and that can talk to each other. And so you're also trying to create a place where they can go to do all those wonderful things. And also at the same time, see the things that you're working on and support you there if they choose to do so. But if not, they can just enjoy the free stuff that you're putting out.
Absolutely. Yeah. So audiobook fans, listeners, readers, come hang out. Authors, especially, you know, if you want to hear what I can do with your book, just send in a request. I'll audition for your work, you know.
Yeah. This guy has to read a bunch of stuff every, you know, multiple episodes a week. So feel free to send him stuff to read. I'm sure I'll be more than happy to crack at it.
need the content. So come on down. Come on down, authors. Hang out with me.
Absolutely. And you read a ton of stuff, not just LitRPG, but also other things from other genres as well. So there's plenty of stuff for everybody, you know, to listen to and to enjoy as some free content. So thanks again, Jeff, for taking the time to talk to me.
It's been
fun. Yeah, it's been really super fun. I had a really nice time talking to you. Like I said, time always goes by so quickly when you just have a nice conversation, man. So thanks a lot. Yeah. And that's going to be it for the show. So everybody, thank you very much for listening to me and Jeff talk and hang out. We love talking about LitRPG, of course, and also cool stuff like audiobook narration. So thanks a lot, everybody, for the LitRPG podcast. I am Ramon Mejia. And of course, Jeff, you want to say goodbye real quick to everybody?
Bye, everybody.
That's it, folks. And until we can meet again, remember to go read some LitRPG.